nothing perfect or considerable. We're so damn good. It's the story of your life. You're moving down the page.
Morning, Glory America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Up at Studio Winterfell, let me begin with a story that is from Greenwood, Indiana. Last night at 6 p.m., a gunman attempted a mass slaughter of innocents at the mall in Greenwood, which is like a mall in everywhere in the United States. It's a Sunday night at 6 p.m., and a killer arrives with a long gun, not yet identified by make, model, or anything, nor is the killer identified. He kills three, and then an armed bystander kills him. From the Washington Post this morning, it was updated last night after midnight East Coast time, but they've done nothing in the 6 hours subsequent. A gunman shot and killed three people and injured two others at a mall in Indiana on Sunday evening before he was fatally shot by a bystander. The gunman, described as an adult male, was armed with a, quote, long gun, appears to act alone, Chief Jim Isson, the Greenwood Police Department said in a news conference. Officers responded to reports of firing about 6 p.m. local time at the food court in the Greenwood Park Mall. And you know what that means. There's a Sbarro and a Chinese takeout place and a few other bakeries and things like that. It's like food courts at every mall in America. Two people wounded by the gunfire were hospitalized at a second news conference. They're in stable condition. The victim included one male and four females. So one dead man, two dead women, one girl is injured, and a, quote, nearby Good Samaritan, according to police, shot the gunman. He added that the Good Samaritan was lawfully carrying a firearm, which he believed was a handgun, appears to be cooperating fully. The bystander, quote, was able to stop the shooter almost as soon as he began. Authorities identify him as a 22-year-old man from Bartholomew County, south of Greenwood. God bless that young man. Had he not been there, I'd be reading you a story of many, many more deaths, because no matter how fast police are, they're not going to be there that quick. We'll find out more as the situation goes along. United Kingdom today in Great Britain and England is going to be the hottest day on record, according to the New York Times. They're expecting 104 degrees, the average temperature across Great Britain. Key thing in the news, for Americans, for Brits, for the world. England, of course, Great Britain, of course, leads the world after the United States. They're our strongest ally. They're a nuclear power. They're key to Ukraine. The British response to Ukraine has been better and faster than the United States response, though we've sent more materiel. They have fought alongside of us in Iraq and Afghanistan. They fought alongside of us in World War II and I. They are our closest allies. There is a special relationship, and they will pick a new leader by the beginning of September, in the next 6 weeks. Last night they had their second debate, and it wasn't available anywhere in the United States, so I followed it as best I can. I'm interested in this because next to our own president, Joe Biden, this is the leader in the world who matters most to us, and very closely followed by the Prime Minister of Israel. They're also going to switch, but Boris, of course, got into scandalous trouble. He got Brexit done, and then it's been rather a very bumpy ride for him, and he's out of the picture. So there are five candidates now: Rishi Sunak, Penny Mordaunt, Tom Tuggenhat, Liz Truss, and Kemi Badenoch. And they went at it for an hour last night on ITV. Here are their closing statements. Rishi Sunak was the Chancellor of the Exchequer until he quit, along with another cabinet member, which led to an avalanche of resignations, which led to Boris throwing in the towel. Here's Rishi Sunak last night, cut number 11, his closing remarks.
My question's for Liz, actually. Liz, in your past, you've been both a Liberal Democrat and a Remainer. I was just wondering which one you regretted most.
I am somebody who was not born.
Stop right there. That was the zinger question. That got the most traction. I'm looking for the closing statements. I think number 11 is Rishi's closing statement. That was the zinger of zinger. That's going to leave a mark because she was a Remainer and she did switch parties from the Liberal Democrats to the Conservatives. And so Rishi is trying to have her out, embarrass her. And he did a good job of that. But now let's go to closing statement, cut number 11.
We have a choice. Do we confront the challenges we face with honesty and responsibility or not? I'm standing because I believe I'm the best person to lead our country and the only candidate who can take the fight to Labour and win the next election for our party. The stakes for our country are high, and only I have the experience needed to deal with this economic crisis. But if we take on our problems with honesty and determination, Britain's potential is limitless. My parents worked hard to give me the opportunity of a better future. And that's what I would do for your children and grandchildren as your Prime Minister.
Next up, Penny Mordaunt, who was leading the race to be the second person on the ballot. Cut number, Penny Mordaunt, closing remarks, whatever number it is.
If you're still watching this debate, well done. I wish tonight had been a little less about us and a bit more about you. I know you've got serious concerns, and these are really uncertain times. Our model of politics is broken. Our model of political leadership is broken. You need someone who knows why it needs to change and has a plan to do that. And that's me.
Then Tom Tuggenhat, who's a member of parliament, hasn't served in any ministerial capacity, is a combat veteran of Iraq and Afghanistan. Cut 13.
Thank you very much for watching this evening. This evening hasn't actually been about us, and in many ways it hasn't been about the Conservative Party. It's been about you and about who you need as your next Conservative Prime Minister. Because the reality is this country has been facing problems abroad and is now facing challenges at home and around the world. And the government, I'm afraid, has led to a lack of trust and a collapse in that confidence. We're all asking the right questions. The real answer is we need a clean start, because we need to restore confidence in our government and in ourselves. We can do it. I'm ready to serve. I'm ready to lead.
Then we have Liz Truss, who is the current foreign secretary. She did not resign. She has been rather stiff and wooden, a little Theresa May-like throughout, but was generally believed to be it was going to be a Liz Truss, Rishi Sunak race. That's changing here. She did better last night than she did on Friday night. Cut number 14.
The next election is going to be about the economy. We only have 2 years to show the British people we can deliver. I can hit the ground running at number 10, driving economic growth by cutting taxes and delivering tough reform. I've shown what I can do on Brexit, on trade, and on Ukraine. I've shown that I'm trusted to deliver. Britain's best days lie ahead. We need to reject the voices of decline. And as Conservatives, we need to stop apologising for who we are. I will lead a government of all the talents that unleashes the full potential of our great country.
And then finally, Kemi Badenoch, who's being backed by Michael Gove, who I think is the smartest guy in Great Britain. Kemi Badenoch is a black Brit who grew up mostly in Nigeria. She's only 42, but she's beginning to turn heads. Cut 15.
I said that I was the candidate who would tell you the truth, and I am. I'm doing this not for myself, but for the future. I have 3 children, and I want the very best future for them. It is vitally important that we create a strong United Kingdom that is confident in itself. I moved to this country nearly 30 years ago, and the United Kingdom is a beacon of shining light in the world. That's why so many people want to come here, and we need to make sure that we keep it so. So a future that is confident, bright, strong, secure, with a wealthier economy. That's what I'm about. I'm the candidate for the future. I'm here to be honest with you. I can make a change and change things for the better.
At 3 o'clock today in Great Britain, which will be 10 o'clock in the United States, East Coast time, the Tory MPs will vote again, and we'll know later in the afternoon here in the United States, who got eliminated. Then they do it again on Tuesday, then they get down to 3. I can't tell you who should win, who's going to win. It's British politics, and it's a member of parliament. There are 348 Brits members, Tory members of parliament. They decide who makes it to the final ballot. 200,000 conservative voters follow, but it matters to us. Some quick takes from the Telegraph's conservative columnist, Juliet Samuel, says Badenoch makes a stand for common sense. Liam Halligan says Tuggenhat has campaigned well, but is now about to be ousted. That's completely true. He's going to go out today. Janet Daly, Badenoch shines as a voice of courage and honesty. Then we go to Ian Dale, Truss blows her chance. And I think there's one more. Yeah, Patrick O'Flynn. Truss and Mordaunt reeked of adrenaline-fueled desperation. Is it possible that the United Kingdom is about to be led by a 42-year-old black woman who spent most of her growing up days in Nigeria? Yes, it is possible. Stranger things have happened. Rishi Sunak remains the odds maker's favorite. But a runoff between Rishi and Kemi would certainly be an interesting face for conservatism global-wide. Stay tuned, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt in the far north at Studio Winterfell. I've just done the rundown on the British Prime Minister election. It's really a Conservative Party race for leadership, and that leader becomes the British Prime Minister for at least a year and a half to 2 years. They won't have elections for 2 years. So it's a big deal, and they could be the next Margaret Thatcher. They could be the next Macron, who's going to be there for a dozen years by the end of his time. It really matters a lot, does it? It's not getting much coverage. I'll tell you what, one of our sponsors, Job Creators Network, has rockthewoke.com going because they're trying to get all of America to articulate in one place that they are against wokeism. And by the way, I think that's going to drive a lot of the electoral earthquake that's coming, is that people have had it with any number of issues that just seem to defy common sense, reason, tradition, the rule of law, basic Christian, Judeo-Christian ethics, basic everything. They've just had it with it, and they don't want schools politicized, and they're sick of politics chasing them into every football and baseball game. They're sick of it all. So rockthewoke.com is where you join part of the Job Creators Network. But if we have Rishi Sunak versus Kemi Badenoch in the final two, that will rockthewoke.com more than anything because, you know, Rishi is the son of immigrants. He's very wealthy. He's done very well. His wife is a particularly flashpoint over there because she's done very well, and her parents started with nothing and made a lot of money, and so they're attacking him for his wealth. But he's a Brit of Indian descent, and then Kemi Badenoch is a Brit of Nigerian descent who grew up mostly in Nigeria, and they're both remarkable people, and that really gives the lie to the idea that the West is systemically racist on behalf of white people, which I just think people think is absurd and stupid. And I know that there's 5% and they're very loud and they want it to be believed, but rockthewoke.com is where you go. And I encourage you to join it right today. Just go there and I think you'll be ahead of it. You'll be pushing business to stop it. Whether it's Disney or American Express, just stop it. And go to rockthewoke.com. Let me do the market update. Friday was a very good day on the market. The Dow was up 658 points. The S&P was up 72. The NASDAQ up 201. This market update from the weekend is brought to you by Birch Gold. If you want to buy gold today, gold is up to $1,721. It dipped down to about 1702 as interest rates continued to spike, thinking some investors and a lot of money just rolling into U.S. Treasuries. The 30-year Treasury is down to 2.93, which is the lowest in a long time. And the Fed is going to raise rates again. Indeed, a bunch of headlines fit into this HughGold.com segment. And if you want to buy gold, go to HughGold.com. If you want to open IRA 401k with physical gold or roll one of your existing IRAs or 401ks over, maybe one of those old ones that you've forgotten about and you got a couple of grand in it and you want to start a place to actually have physical gold, they'll send you the complete information kit if you go to HughGold.com or text Hugh to 989898, H-U-G-H to 989898. Financial Times, central banks embrace big rises to bolster currencies and fight inflation. Wall Street Journal, Fed officials preparing to lift interest rates by another 0.75 percentage point. Washington Post, soaring dollar could help Fed in fight against inflation. Wall Street Journal, many investors are fleeing the stock market, but some are doubling down. If I lose $15,000, I'm not going to die. People don't know what to do with their money. If you want to be cautious and you know that inflation is here for a while, I think the Fed may go a full point at their meeting in July in Jackson Hole. I think it's in Jackson Hole. If you want to just be hedged against runaway inflation, the Fed just can't get ahead of it. The European Central Bank can't get ahead of it. Then head to HughGold.com, HughGold.com. Now, the economy is the economy, and there are a couple other stories. Make sure that you hear them. Texas House report says everyone at Uvalde failed. There were 700 law enforcement there. 700 law enforcement there. Two foreign affairs story. The Afghanistan economy crumbles since Taliban takeover. And then this morning in the Wall Street Journal, Afghanistan maternity care is faltering. What did we expect? What did we expect? Coming up on the year anniversary of bugging out. Against all of this backdrop, inflation, Afghanistan, a British leadership race, the head of the Republican Governors Association, Doug Ducey, goes on CNN yesterday with Dana Bash. She's a good reporter. I like Dana. Dana and I work very well together. I don't think she's particularly ideological one way or the other. And very, very left-wing questions. And Doug Ducey put on a seminar on how to deal with it. And so I'm going to play you the entire interview of Doug Ducey and Dana Bash from yesterday because I said that's how you deal with a biased CNN, a biased MSNBC, a biased legacy media everywhere. You reframe and answer the question you want to answer. So if you're a candidate or a friend of a candidate or a conservative who argues with their friends and family, listen to the next segment on The Hugh Hewitt Show. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Look, I don't normally watch the Sunday shows, especially in the summertime. But Doug Ducey is the governor of Arizona, and he was on with Dana Bash yesterday. Everyone's on vacation. Dana is sitting in for Jake Tapper on State of the Union. And Doug agrees to do it in studio, so they take him. And it's a very, very left-wing interview set of questions. I don't blame Dana. The old producers are putting up a last stand in Alamo against the new people from Discovery to stop CNN from being taken away from them as their plaything with no viewers. But Dana follows sort of the predictable, let's try and make some news that will please a left-wing audience script. And Governor Ducey is among the most thoughtful of governors. And so I'm just going to play you 10 minutes of how to deal with a lefty. Here is Dana Bash, Doug Ducey, talking to Dana Bash yesterday.
Your state's primary is now just over 2 weeks away. You and the former president are on opposite sides of this primary battle. And the candidate he is supporting says the 2020 election was stolen. So what's at stake in this race for your state and for the overall Republican Party and its future?
Well, the names on the ballot are Karen Taylor Robeson and Carrie Lake. And Karen Taylor Robeson is the real conservative. She's the real deal. She started her career working for Ronald Reagan. She's pro-wall, pro-gun, pro-life. She's the mother of four. She's been a community leader and a successful business person. And I think Karen Taylor Robeson will be the best person to be a fresh new leader for the state of Arizona. Her opponent, on the other hand, bears no resemblance, her campaign or even her personal interactions with me, to anything she's done over the past 30 years. This is all an act. She's been putting on a show for some time now, and we'll see if the voters of Arizona buy it.
And how does this play into the national conversation, particularly about, as I mentioned, the election in 2020? Carrie Lake is backed by the former president, in large part because she says the 2020 election was stolen.
Well, Carrie Lake's misleading voters with no evidence. She's been tagged by her opponents with the nickname Fake Lake, which seems to be sticking and actually doing some damage. Karen Taylor Robeson started from zero, and now this is a margin of error race.
Will the Republican Governors Association support Carrie Lake in the general election if she wins the primary?
All post-August 2nd rolls are to be determined. Now, the Republican Governors Association is in the business of electing Republican governors, and we happen to be very good at it. We're the only majority Republican conference in the country. We protect our incumbents. We keep our red states red. And, Dana, we're on offense all over the country right now. This is the most expansive map we've ever had. Oregon just came online, so we're on offense. But we don't support lost causes. We certainly don't support landslides. We go into states where the races are competitive, and we get the good candidate over the finish line.
So let me expand beyond Arizona. Doug Mastriano has already won the Republican nomination in Pennsylvania for that governor's race. Will the RGA support him, or is he in that category of lost cause?
No, I didn't say lost cause in any category yet.
But I'm asking
November 8th
is
a long ways.
Okay, so will the RGA support him in Pennsylvania?
November 8th is a long way off. So we'll be looking at this map. We'll be looking at the resources we have. And we don't know what September and October are going to hold. We don't know who the next Charlie Baker in Massachusetts, Larry Hogan in Maryland, or Glenn Youngkin in Virginia is going to be. So we'll make those decisions targeted on a basis on how we can have success and results. We don't spread the dollars pro rata across the country. We go into states where people have moved numbers,
right,
demonstrated
so
that they can build coalitions, and we win those races.
So let me ask you on a personal level, do you, Doug Ducey, who does not believe the 2020 election was stolen either in your home state of Arizona or in Pennsylvania, think that someone like Doug Mastriano should be in such an important swing state in the governor's mansion?
I think that the people of any state would be better served by a governor who believes in the people, believes that small businesses should be allowed to operate, and believes that children should be in classrooms. I also think this election should be about the future. Mm-hmm. I don't think we should think for one more moment about 2020. This is about the 2022 election cycle. And as I said, The job of the RGA is to elect Republican governors, and that's what we're going to do in this cycle.
I want to ask about January 6th. Your state House Speaker and your friend, Rusty Bowers, testified before that committee about the direct pressure he got from Donald Trump, John Eastman, and Rudy Giuliani. You told me last year on the show that Donald Trump bears some responsibility for January 6th. Do you believe his actions on January 6th, or inaction, should disqualify him for holding public office in the future?
Dana, I condemned January 6th, and I think everyone that broke the law should be held accountable. In our system, this is up to the voters on what happens next. So many people want to talk about 2024, and I want to resist that temptation to talk about hypotheticals. I think the best way for us to turn this page and to move forward as a conservative Republican Party and a country is to make sure we get the best possible people elected in 2022. And that's my focus, as well as running the state of Arizona every single day.
If Donald Trump runs in 2024, will you support him?
I think we will have options in the 2024 primary race. I am hopeful we will have options, and I want somebody who can win that general election, because I believe with success in 2022, the general election is the Republican Party's for the taking.
Let's talk about a couple of really important issues that voters are talking about and thinking about: gas prices. Gas prices in your state in Arizona are still at $4.85 per gallon, well above the national average. President Biden wants a gas tax holiday on a national level, but also for states. Will you support temporarily lifting Arizona's gas tax?
Arizona has the lowest flat tax in the nation. We just passed the largest tax decrease in the history of our state. Meanwhile, President Biden is flying to the Middle East and fist bumping with murderers and despots asking for more supply. What he could do is open up the Keystone Pipeline. What he could do is work with America's energy leaders and provide more supply of fossil fuels, of clean energy, and solve this crisis. He's going to have to make that decision. We're not going to do anything in Arizona that's temporary or a gimmick or puts my successor in a terrible spot with the voters. We're going to have good policy here, and Joe Biden could lead from the White House as well.
Governor, you signed a 15-week abortion ban into law in March. Your state's attorney general is trying to reinstate a 1901 law from before Arizona was a state, which bans all abortion except to save the life of a mother. Will you support that? Should abortion be banned in Arizona?
Well, listen, Dana, I know you know that I'm proudly pro-life. Arizona is considered the number one most pro-life state in the nation. I was supportive of the Supreme Court's actions. I believe that Roe versus Wade was wrongly decided, and now it comes back to the states. The law that I signed was the 15-week abortion law, and the legal authority inside the state in terms of opinions is our attorney general. This will be left to the courts to decide, but ultimately it should come back to the legislatures and the people to make these decisions.
So do you support a total ban or do you not? What do you personally believe as governor?
And what I ran on in 2014 is that I am pro-life with exceptions for life of the mother, rape, and incest, and that's what I remain.
You signed a new school voucher program into law, and it lets any student in your state use publicly funded vouchers to help pay for private schools. But since all students are eligible, some critics of what you signed say it will funnel state dollars to wealthy families who can already afford private schools. So why should wealthy families who can afford private school be eligible for state vouchers?
Arizona is now the gold standard for educational freedom. And these are not vouchers. This is a scholarship for all 1,100,000 of Arizona students. And I'm not concerned about the wealthy families. I'm concerned about the poor families. 50 years ago, politicians stood in the schoolhouse door and wouldn't let minorities in. Today, union-backed politicians stand in the schoolhouse door and won't let minorities out. It's time to set these families free. They are trapped in failing public schools, and now they will have a way out, and they'll be able to learn, grow, and climb the economic ladder in the United States of America, in Arizona first. And I encourage all my governors, both Republican and Democrat, to take this bill in Arizona, take educational savings accounts, and make sure everyone in your state has access to their taxpayer dollars so they can get the education of their parents' choice.
Governor, if your focus is on low-income students, making sure that they get the same choices as those who have wealthy parents, why not just focus the public funding on them? Why also give public funding to wealthy families?
Public education is about educating our public, and I believe in equal opportunity for all of our students and all of our families. I really think this is the way to renew American K-12 education, to renew America, to have an education where you're learning something of value, of math, reading, science, American civics, character formation. Arizona leads on this already as the number one state for school choice. And now with educational savings accounts, we're going to take it to the next level.
Now, that was the end of it. Now, I got to tell you, Dana got to the issue of most importance to Americans at the very last moment. Educational backpack funding, where school revenue, taxpayer dollars follow the student. They figure out the per student funding. Each student gets that amount of money. They can take it wherever they want to go. It is a revolution. Arizona is leading a revolution in education. It's the very last question. After Karen Robson and the Kerry Lake discussion, which is of some interest to inside the Beltway types and Arizonans certainly, but of zero interest to everyone else. And then they end with the priority, which is you just pass education choice, the most radical education choice experiment in the history of the modern United States. Can you tell us about it? What do parents need to know about? It's going to affect every parent in Arizona. It should affect every American citizen. The last question thrown in, barely discussed. That's what's wrong with the news. That's what they want to talk about, the 2020 election, because that's CNN's whole game of everything. And I don't want to say nobody cares, but you know, 1% of America cares. Everyone's made up their mind. It was a riot. It was terrible. You know, prosecute everyone. Doesn't look to me like anyone on Team Trump has any kind of criminal liability, but DOJ can decide that. Tell me what's going to happen to the kids. Tell me what's going to happen if this spreads. What's going to happen to teachers' unions? What's going to happen to public education? Is it good for the country? Missed opportunity. 10 minutes wasted. That's what's wrong with media. You know, what's right with me is relieffactor.com. I'm back up at Studio Winterfell, and I have my full supply. And I did 8 miles on Saturday. I'm getting ready for a 10K, but is organized up here annually in about 4 or 5 weeks. I'm going to tell you right now that this is a great thing. I started taking it on Friday when I got back. I flew up from D.C. to Portland International Jetport. I love that. Portland International Jetport, because they fly to Canada. And I started driving down east. I flew up with Senator Blunt from Missouri, by the way. Great guy. Wonderful to chat with him in the jetway, etc. But started driving, thinking, I got to drive faster, I got to get to my relief factor. And I got to my relief factor, first thing I did, get my relief factor back in my system because the studio King's Landing has been looted of its relief factor. 1995, inflation's not touched the starter pack. Go and get going with it. Up next, Salena Zito. Do not miss that. Stay tuned.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Job Creators Network.
Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. Time for the Yinzer Report with our buddy in Pittsburgh, Salena Zito, a columnist for the New York Post, the national political reporter for Washington Examiner. She also writes in the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette. And in the latter, she recently concluded the people who live in the rows of tidy middle-class homes in tree-lined suburbs and who run the small businesses along Main Street or the light industrial complexes along the river will make a choice this fall. Either go with the status quo, which every poll in America tells us they are deeply disappointed with, or go with someone whose message actually responds to their concerns. Salena, you know, everyone's watching. Josh Shapiro is going to take Doug Mastriano apart at the joint. But the question is Oz versus Fetterman and what's going on in your state. Just tell us, do the attacks on Dr. Oz's many houses work for a disabled John Fetterman?
No, it doesn't. It's really interesting. I'll have a piece this week. I've spent the last few days out there on the road. Fetterman has, you know, his appeal has always been his ability to go out there and, you know, into these towns and these places that people have forgotten and talk to people about economic populism in a way that was appealing and the way that other Democrats have been unable to do for about the past 10 years. Unfortunately, he is not out there due to his stroke and also his heart problems. And so he has decided that his way into the hearts and minds of Pennsylvania voters is to do posts on Twitter that are off-color or gimmicky or smart-alecky, and in particular about New Jersey. I mean, he has Snooki out there doing ads for him, and it's not cutting it. This is not why people voted for him in a primary. This is not why people donated to him, in particular flying airplanes over a New Jersey beach. People think that there are problems that are going on are incredibly serious, whether it is inflation, whether it is crime, whether it is the border, whatever the problem is, they believe these problems are serious and are impacting not just ourselves, but our future generations.
Well, you know, I've seen in the Beltway is the attacks on Oz having a bunch of houses. Now, Dr. Oz is very rich, fabulously wealthy. He's not a billionaire or anything, but he's very rich. And from northeastern Pennsylvania to southwestern Pennsylvania, John Fetterman keeps attacking him for having a house in, you know, Turkey, a house in England. He's got houses everywhere because he made a lot of money as a TV doctor. That doesn't, I don't think that actually works, but maybe it does. Maybe Pennsylvanians are wealth envious. It's never struck me as being class warfare has never worked in Pennsylvania.
You know, the outside the Beltway type reporters who haven't actually been in Pennsylvania, you know, they're writing stories. I saw this story, "Where is Dr. Oz?" And I'm like, well, I just spent a long time going across the state with him, 2,000 miles, 49 different towns, you know, just exhaustive work. And it was all because they hadn't seen any ads. Well, you know, you have to build relationships, in particular after a bruising primary. And he's out there in these places building these relationships with people and listening to their concerns. And outside, a lot of outside the Beltway type reporters are saying, oh, well, you know, Dr. Oz is going to lose because, you know, he's not on the airwaves. Well, he actually is on the airwaves. He has an aspirational message, but he's not doing what John Fetterman is doing. And in the same way that these outside the Beltway, I mean, these inside the Beltway reporters thought that Connor Lamb was going to win because that's all they knew was Connor Lamb, they think that John Fetterman's going to win because he has tattoos and he's doing poop posting on Twitter And that's going to make him, the next U.S. Senator from Pennsylvania.
It's awfully condescending. I mean, I like to tweak the Steelers fans, but this is an awfully condescending tone in the national media. Now, I think a lot of it comes from the fact that John Fetterman can't do anything, right? He's actually impaired. No. Is he impaired? I mean, can he talk?
I don't know. He's done a couple of ads. And he's done a couple events. Now, these are very staged events at his campaign headquarter-type places, right?
Isn't that a national story, whether or not he can talk?
No. Nobody has done that story.
Let me rephrase the question. Should it be a national story, whether or not the Democrats have nominated an incapacitated individual?
Well, I think it's interesting that he's the lieutenant governor of Pennsylvania. We don't know anything about health. Why is that not a story?
It is astonishing to me that if the left narrative of legacy media thinks it is hurtful to Democrats to cover something, they don't. And yet we had 10 minutes with Doug Ducey and Dana Bash yesterday, and they didn't cover school choice in Arizona. It's just upside down world. SelenaZito.com for everything Selena. That might be the most important race in America, Dr. Oz versus John Fetterman. And you'll find out the most from SelenaZito.com. Don't go anywhere. I'll be back. Hour two of the Monday edition of the Hugh Hewitt Show right ahead. Morning, Glory America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. From Studio Winterfell, I'm back up north. I'm joined by Jake Sherman, editor of PunchbowlNews.com, your free newsletter. But for one of the few days I've ever had Jake on, I haven't read Punchbowl News this morning. I don't know if they're off for a couple of weeks. I suspect they are. Or he's working overtime on the fact that Ben Affleck and Jennifer Lopez got married in Las Vegas at midnight last night. Is that what's going on, Jake Sherman?
No, Hugh. No, we are out this morning. I don't know if you didn't get it yet, but we are out.
Okay, well, then you're going to have to fill me in because I can't find it. And I, what'd you make of the J-Lo Ben Affleck news? I know that probably captured your complete attention.
I am completely disinterested in their
You and me both. Okay, let's move on to whether or not the CHIPS Act. I got to say, Micron.com sponsors this show. They are big on the CHIPS Act. Before they came along, I was big on the CHIPS Act. I wanted to get to it. We need fabrication plants. Are they going to go to conference this week?
They're not going to go to conference. They are going to pass this thing. They're already in conference. And the conference has been completely useless for a lot of reasons that we don't have to get into here. But number one, the Senate passed a bipartisan bill. Pelosi didn't take it up. They went to a conference. There's 100-plus people in the conference. It was never going to work. The House and Senate don't disagree. Republicans don't agree with Republicans. Democrats don't agree with Democrats. So what's going to happen this week, Hugh, is they are going to take they're going to start the process to passing a bill with $52 billion in subsidies for the chip industry, the semiconductor industry, coupled with tax breaks for companies that produce semiconductors, essentially related tax breaks. This is a big deal. There might be more pieces added in, but we don't know what those pieces are yet. But the basic thing that unlocked this, Hugh, is that Senate Democrats pared back their reconciliation package to not include taxing and spending priorities, just that Medicare and ACA subsidies, which John Cornyn said was okay. He's not going to vote for it, I don't imagine. But the threat kind of backed off.
So talk to me a little bit, though, about this. They're going to run back CHIPS to the beginning and start over. CHIPS is different from reconciliation. Reconciliation is a spend bill. CHIPS is a spend bill. They're two different bills. Reconciliation is not Build Back Better. It's just Medicare subsidies. And I don't know if they're going to do Obamacare dollars. I don't know if that's going to get through. I don't know if the House is going to vote for it. But I'm focused on...
They will.
So there are two bills, and you expect these two bills to be done this week?
No, I don't expect them to be done this week. I expect the CHIPS bill to start moving. They're going to vote to proceed to it tomorrow, and I expect that they will begin putting together that reconciliation package, which is, again, narrowly targeted. It is just allowing Medicare to negotiate for lower drug prices, and the ACA subsidies, averting a rate hike for the ACA.
So they're both starting in the Senate. And who
correct.
Is writing CHIPS? I mean, John Cornyn wrote the gun law, which got eventually done after an intense bit of negotiations. But John Cornyn led the working group. Who is running the working group on CHIPS, Democrat, and is it in the Senate exclusively at this point?
There is no working group because they're basically pulling this out of USICA. It's already written. And it's going to be put together with another existing bill called the FABS Act, which is a Ron Wyden bill. Both of those bills have broad bipartisan support. The problem is the House is just, first of all, they're not making any progress on the USICA conference committee. And they're going to try to add more into that CHIPS bill if there's more agreement. But it's not going to be USICA. It's not going to be the kind of broad-based reformation of the National Science Foundation and things of that nature. The Republicans are actually okay with that because they believe a lot of those authorities actually sit with DARPA and the Defense Department, which they think could do a better job than the National Science Foundation. So we'll have to see how that ends up. But I believe the core of this bill is going to be that $52 billion for semiconductor manufacturers.
Yeah, I get back to what I've told people for weeks, is that you need air, water, food, and semiconductor chips to live. And we got the air, water, and food stuff. This is the semiconductor chip bill. How do we get it reshored to the United States and do what Ohio and Arizona does, which is build new fabrication plants for chips? That's what it's about. But someone's got to write it. They can't just, when you say someone's going to pull it out of a bill, That's actually not going to be what happens. Somebody has to write it, and they have to agree, McConnell and Schumer, on what's going to be in it. And who's that somebody? I mean, whose team is doing it? It's not one person. I imagine
the leadership will do it. I imagine the leadership will do it. But, again, this bill exists in existence. I want to say one other thing, Hugh. What you said about Ohio and all the states in the U.S., Gina Raimondo was up on Capitol Hill last week and told us that all of these domestic chip companies are in France right now, in Germany, in Korea, negotiating for subsidies to build fabs there. So it's actually a quite dire problem. And Raimondo said last week, if the Congress doesn't pass it this week, a lot of these companies are going to pull up stakes and go abroad, which is not something, obviously, not something that the Congress wants to happen.
Well, what I obviously think is going on is that there's horse trading about where will these plants be built. And, you know, you get one of these things and you're a big winner. I flew into Portland with Roy Blunt and didn't ask him, do you get one from Missouri? But my assumption is, forget the House. The House is just a gaggle of crazy people at this point. My assumption is if they could get 50 fab plants and put one in every state, that's what they would do. But they can't do that. They're very expensive. You get $52 billion, you're going to get five of these things. And they got to figure out where they're going to go. And it's actually, the Senate's not going to say, we don't care where it goes, go where you want, here's the money. I mean, that's just not how it works, is it, Jake?
No, probably not. And by the way, some of these have been announced, right? The Ohio one has been announced. There's talk of one in Arizona. Chuck Schumer has been lobbying hard for one in New York, a big facility, I believe, in Rochester. But whatever state these go to is going to be a boon for them. It's going to be an absolute boon.
That's why it's sort of like the infrastructure bill 2.0. Only this is real infrastructure because literally it's air, water, food, and semiconductor chips to live in 2022. But somebody's got to make that choice. And I assume McConnell and Schumer know they got to get the 60. So you got to get 10 Republicans and 50 Democrats, and everybody's got to be happy with it. The House will pass whatever gets over there. And you're just, what I hear you saying is McConnell's got this held tight. We don't know who he's telling to draft it. He said Cornyn's in charge of guns, but he has not named anyone to be in charge of chips.
No, he is not. Todd Young, John Cornyn, all those people are very key in this. And I think that at this point, with the speed with which they want to move, they're going to have to negotiate this out at the leadership level.
That's it. My prediction is Maine's going to get one of these. Portland, I'm on WGAN, and I think Susan Collins is going to go in and say, okay, I took all the heat over this Supreme Court thing. I want a chips production facility in north of Portland, near the International Portland Jetport. Jake Sherman, tell me one more thing about the reconciliation. Is that a done deal? Because I actually don't think Republicans want. They might say, they may not be able to stop it, but I don't think you're going to get any votes for that, are they?
You know, I actually don't know the answer to that. It will be a tough vote for some Republicans because if you think about it, and I'll try to keep this quick, Hugh, but I've just been thinking a lot about the politics of this. When they were talking about a massive package with climate and tax hikes and all this stuff, it would have been really easy for Republicans to say no. But now Democrats actually have a decent message out of this bill, which is we made drugs cheaper for old people. And I think there are going to be some Republicans who take a look at it. I ultimately think it's going to be a pretty party line bill. Maybe you peel off one, maybe you peel off a Collins or a Murkowski. I don't know. I don't think you peel off anyone in the House that I could think of at this moment. But I do think that it actually is a tougher vote for a lot of Republicans.
Well, I think it's a tough vote for Democrats because they're going to spend billions more on subsidies for favored groups, in this case, individual participants in the Obamacare marketplace. That's who wins with this bill. They're going to subsidize those premiums, right? Bottom line, this is not partisan. This bill is about subsidizing the premiums of Obamacare recipients, right?
Yeah, partially, but actually there is deficit reduction in here because the Medicare provision saves, I think, I'm going to be wrong on these numbers, but I'm going to be close. I think it saves $600 billion, and I think the Obamacare for 2 years is $200 or $300 billion.
And so Jake, this audience is not fuzzy math. Doesn't work. Medicare reductions have been factored into bills for 100 years. That's for the CBO to decide. But yes, the benefits of this thing, I mean, the people who get anything out of this, are people who get Obamacare insurance through the individual exchanges.
That's
right
true.
Or wrong?
That's true. Yes.
That is true. And so it's an inflationary subsidy. I think Democrats are shooting themselves in the foot, but that's up to them to do. Hey, Jake Sherman, I will go find my Punchbowl news. I just don't know why it didn't come through. Maybe you've exiled me from, like, your annual party. I've been taken off because I bring up, and maybe, I don't know, Jake, but we'll go find it. Punchbowlnews.com. Subscribe to the newsletter, get it every morning. Come right back to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Micron.
Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. I was out on the ocean with my brother-in-law and sister-in-law and the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt and a couple of friends yesterday, and it was a beautiful day up far on the Atlantic coast. And I'm here to tell you, it's wonderful to be out of D.C. for the summer, but I have homework to do. I'm going down, and Dwayne is flying out for the ALEC conference, American Legislative Exchange Council.org, ALEC.org. And I know most of these issues. I was talking to the CEO of ALEC on Friday of last week, or maybe Thursday of last week, about unfunded pension liabilities. And there's almost $9 trillion of promises made that can't be kept by state and local governments. And you know what an unfunded pension liability is. That's when a company or a government at any level says to the people who work for it, we're going to pay you a pension based on how many years you put in. Mrs. Generalissimo has worked for California schools teaching for years. Mr. Generalissimo, how many years until she retires?
She's got to go another, she's almost got her 30 years in. She's got to go another 6.5 years until she's old enough to actually use it.
Okay, so Generalissimo and Mrs. Generalissimo are not old enough to retire, but they will be in 6.5 years. And then Mrs. Generalissimo will get a promised pension for laboring in the vineyards of California education for 37 years. An unfunded pension liability means they don't have the money to pay all the promises they've made to her and everybody else in the California Teachers Association, everybody else in the public employee retirement system. And it's all over the country because elected officials who are looking for votes today make promises tomorrow. And it's the old wimpy Popeye. For a hamburger today, I will gladly pay you Tuesday. And the American Legislative Exchange Council just goes about, it's a think tank for state legislators. And I've never gone to one before, and I'm very excited about going to their annual meeting and talking to a bunch of them, because that's where most of the answer to inflation lies. We have to increase productivity to bring down inflation. That's the end of it. You got to get more goods out there so that the sea of dollars that were printed in the last 3 years has some place to go that's real, not fake. You know, the Fed just can't make up purchases of fake things. You've got to actually buy things. You have to increase productivity. But looming over everything is this iceberg of unfunded pension liability. We'll talk about that. ALEC.org. I want you to go over to that. Now, I have to tell you about the stupidest discussion of the day. I want to spend all my time talking about the British election, because that matters more to me and you. I'm writing a column on the Washington Post for it this week about, you know, if legacy media had been alive, they would have carried the candidate debate in the United Kingdom last night, because one of those five people is going to lead our closest ally in about a month, 6 weeks to be specific. And in 3 days, they're going to be down to two people. And there are five candidates left, and there's Rishi Sunak, who's going to be in the runoff. Rishi is the establishment candidate, and that's okay. He's pretty good, but he's kind of old school. We have to raise taxes, and we have to tighten down, and we have to live through misery. And the other four are new schools. We're going to cut taxes. We're going to go supply side. We're going to get rid of regulations. Brexit's just done. We're going to tell the EU to pound sand. We're not leaving Northern Ireland behind. The customs border is going to be at the border. Yeah, they have a bunch of Brexit-related issues, but mostly it's about productivity and it's about education. It's about being able to buy a house. There aren't enough houses in the United Kingdom, just like in the United States. So that's a real story. The other real story, though, is last night a killer went to a mall south of Indianapolis and tried to kill a bunch of people and, in fact, killed three people. And then a, quote, good Samaritan, close quote, took out a handgun and shot him dead before he killed more. That's the whole story. We don't know much about it. The good Samaritan is 22 years old and used a handgun. We don't know the bad guy, who he was. He was using a long gun, which they don't know what the maker model is yet. And there's a debate, not over whether or not it was a good thing for a civilian, and it's a civilian. We don't know anything about their background, don't know if they're law enforcement, 22 years old, to take out a handgun and shoot a guy who's about to kill as many people as he can. I think it's a good thing. He's been referred to as a, quote, good Samaritan, and the left wing went nuts. We'll talk about it after the break. Don't go anywhere. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by the American Legislative Exchange Council. Visit ALEC.org for more info.
You know, this song was big 1,000 years ago. Sonny Bunch had a piece in the Washington Post over the weekend. Yes, the movie stars are getting older, noting that Tom Cruise turns 60 next month, and that even all the Chrises, Thor and Galaxy Guardians, all the Chrises are going to be 40 or already 40. Everybody's getting older, and Nancy Pelosi is 82, and President Biden's going to be 80, and everyone's getting older. And Sonny Bunch just wryly observed how everyone's getting older. And so nobody remembers this song unless you are over 55. And that song was a joke about sending kids to camp. Well, kids still go off to camp, and parents still have fun. But my torturer friends at The Wild Adventure, TWA.us, send me their postcards, just like kids at camp are obliged to write a postcard to mom and dad saying, I have not been injured. A bear did not eat me. Send mosquito spray. Whatever they sent. And my favorite postcard this week is from Paul from Connecticut, a submariner going fly fishing. Who knew how much he would learn about the world on a ranch? Gotta go. And Jack writes, I listen to you every day and finally made it to the Wild Adventure. Best week of my life. As a man now retired, trying to figure out how to finish my fourth quarter and finish strong and make an impact. There are also young gun groups out there, under 35, and they've got just a couple of spaces left between August 4 and 9th and August 25 and 30. But they send me these postcards because Jan thinks it's funny because I'm trapped in a studio. I'm not so trapped up north, down east. But I was trapped in the Beltway last week, and I really didn't want to read about people who were fly fishing in Montana. And then I got them this week, and it's a lot easier when you get them and you're way up. Close to down east. And, you know, Maine's a big place. Maine's an enormous place. And it's cool. It's been cool all summer. That's why I come up here. And it just, my brother-in-law took me out on his boat. I don't have a boat. I could hurt people. I was trying to learn how to drive the boat by looking over his shoulder yesterday. But out on the Atlantic, there's just no better place to be when it's cool than in Maine. Except maybe Montana. I got an audio clip of all the people who go to the Wild Adventure. And you've got to make reservations for next summer now. TWA.us. Costs $3,100, so you may need a scholarship from one of your buddies. You may want to send your son or your husband because it does make them better. Roll the audio for me, Adam, would you?
Where are you right now?
Right now I'm in Wild Adventure, Montana, and I love it. I'm standing here at the beautiful Smiling Moose Lodge.
In the great state of Montana.
Right outside of Bozeman, Montana, in the Smiling Moose Lodge.
In Montana.
What are you doing in Montana?
I'm here for the Wild Adventure. Just finished up our week. It was awesome.
I'm involved in men's ministry in my home church, but it's nothing like this.
I did some fishing. I met some new people and just had a great time just relaxing and being out in an amazingly beautiful setting and just enjoying my time.
Fly fishing, connecting with great men, fellowshipping with them, and eating really good food.
It was awesome.
Really?
So, yeah, it was an awesome experience.
I got probably 12 new friends I didn't know before.
Came with an acquaintance and I'm leaving with 10 brothers.
That is a typical exit interview. Jan Genera, who founded the Wild Adventure decades ago, always talks to people as they are leaving. Don't talk to them when they're coming in. They don't even know how to fish. And some people leave like me and they still don't know how to fish. But Dwayne loved it. Carl, everybody I know, Bud loved it. Everyone who's ever been on the show loved it. I've never met anyone who did not love it because it's pretty hard not to love Montana and just getting away. Your cell phone does not work at the Smiling Moose Ranch. Does not work. That itself is a gift. But the young guns come up there and they don't, you know, they're 35 and they're rising in their careers. They don't know what to do. And they're kind of saying, what in the world am I going to do for the next 40 years? I've started a company or two, or I'm working at a company I don't like or whatever. Doesn't matter where you are. If you either go to Young Guns or you go to the Smiling Moose, just go over to TWA.us. Everybody loves it. And you got to sign up for next summer now. Or people always complain to me in December that all the spots are gone. I know it's going to happen. You do it every year. All the spots are gone. Well, it is now July. And I'm telling you, you can probably find a spot next summer that fits your calendar. You don't want to commit. You're thinking about it. Don't let your husband get away with it. Go sign up for them. Now, I want to go back to the Good Samaritan controversy, if I could. Yesterday at 6 p.m., after the British debate had finished and the Fetching Miss Sue and I were going to go down and watch Foyle's War. And I have never watched Foyle's War. She watched it years ago. It started in 2002. And it's really a wonderful Brit show, and you know, you got to buy Acorn or BritBox or something like that to get it. And it's about Great Britain during the war. And one of the back themes of it is fly fishing, by the way. And that was a very funny commentary on the wild adventure, because one of the key characters in last night's episode that we watched from season 2, episode 3, I think, and is a German who has fled to the United Kingdom during war, who is quite certain that there are Brits doing business with the Nazis, as there were, and they're out fly fishing. And it's a commentary on fly fishing, which I wholly agree. I don't know if there's any sport more designed to make people crazy than fly fishing, except you get a pint at the end. And that's pretty much what The Wild Adventure is about. But I was watching this and I'm thinking to myself, this is a country at war. And it's very, very, very real about what is going on. But the country is unmolested in Hastings, which is down on the south coast. Largely, an occasional bomb falls, but they don't make anything. That Hastings isn't vital for the Luftwaffe to hit. It's just an occasional errant bomb falls there, but everyone's gone. All the young men are gone, and the kids are running around salvaging stuff and trying to win chocolate, and rationing is in effect, and ration books are everywhere. And it's a real trip through the rabbit hole into 1940 United Kingdom, and it's very well done, meaning that it takes you to a time and place you don't know anything about. I love reading about the Blitz. The Blitz is underway. It's 1940 still in the series, and they will move through the war with various what happens to police work during the war. Guess what? It continues, because criminals are still criminals. Contrast with today. Right? So everybody is armed. Everyone is in the home guard or the service. Everyone is coming home and wounded, or they're staying on the front line for 4.5 years. They're about to invade North Africa in the next season, and they're on their heels. Dunkirk has happened, all right? I'm already through Dunkirk in season 1. And Churchill is not evident anywhere in this, although you'll get an occasional glimpse of the cabinet at work or some ministry at work. And contrast with today. And so everyone does their job. Yesterday, a good Samaritan. Now, the weekly reading 2 weeks ago was the Good Samaritan parable, with which everyone is familiar. When the kingdom of ancient Israel divided into Judah in the south and Israel in the north, Israel went into bondage. The northern kingdom, into slavery much earlier than Judah did. And the captives sent in 5 different peoples into Samaria. And some Jews came back eventually, but the Samaritans are a country apart, and they don't get along with the Galileans or Judeans, and they don't get along at all. So the Good Samaritan is the fellow who's walking down a street or a path or a road and sees that someone has been set upon by criminals and beaten to within an inch of his life. And it's a Jew. And good Samaritans normally won't even touch Jews, and Jews won't touch Samaritans. So the Samaritan goes over and helps this guy out, takes him to an inn, pays for his care, says, I'll pay you the rest when I come back. And Jesus says to the people who are asking, this guy is the real deal. Be a good Samaritan, meaning help people with whom you disagree completely, fundamentally, ethnically, religiously. Be of help to everyone. Do as much as you can for as many as you can for as long as you can. So, at a mall last night, I think it's at a Dick's Sporting Goods store, I'm not sure, a nut comes in, and we'll find out, it's going to be a young white man, 18 to 23, who's got severe psychiatric problems, who is known by local police. We're going to find out. And the red flag law, if there's one in Indiana, didn't work, and this person has a gun, for some reason, he shoots dead 3 people, and he wounds another one. And then a good Samaritan pulls a handgun out and shoots him repeatedly, apparently 3 or 4 times, because there are a few shots fired, and then a couple of moments later, a few more shots fired. And there's a movie here. There's a hero involved. Who is the civilian who doesn't run away, but rather runs towards the violence? What they did not do in Uvalde. What 400 different police officers and state law enforcement, 400 people with guns, let a man in a classroom execute children and teachers. And we're still all kind of shocked at the collective cowardice as opposed to the individual heroism on display. And it's not cowardice so much as it's paralysis. I think all those people, I don't want to slander anyone, they were paralyzed by bad command, by people just froze, deer in the headlights stuff. And they froze, didn't know what to do. And if you haven't thought through what to do, if you haven't trained what to do, you will freeze. Well, last night, this guy, whoever it is, we know it's a man who's 22 years old, we don't know anything else yet. I just am amazed by how we don't know who the hero is. He's a hero. He stopped a killer from killing more. There are 3 grieving families and other wounded people whose lives have been forever radically changed because they were shopping at a Dick's Sporting Goods on a Sunday night. It is a tragic evil that has befallen these families in Indiana, the same as in Uvalde, but there are fewer because a hero had a gun and knew how to use it. Can't be me. I don't have guns. I don't know how to use them. And it could be you. Maybe you have a gun. You know how to use them. It could have been a law enforcement. It would have eventually had to be law enforcement. And the call came in at 6, and the killer was dead by the time law enforcement got there. Is he a good Samaritan is how the left has decided to fight this battle. They don't want good stories out there about good guys with guns stopping bad guys with guns because they hate that saying, no matter how many times it's true. But if someone is going to go on a killing rampage, the only way to kill, stop the killer is to kill, wound, or disarm. Sometimes you can talk them out in a hostage situation, but it's very rare. Very rare. And so more and more states are letting more and more people carry more and more weapons. And I just assume, I was out to dinner with new friends on Saturday night, and I just assume at any given time, you know, you look around, you're situationally aware. In fact, the new Brad Thor novel, Rising Tiger, has within it an Indian, as in from the state of India, our ally, operative who's a CIA sort of person, who walks right towards something is wrong. Something is registering wrong. But it talks about how after every Mumbai or after every 9/11 or after every terrorism attack, everybody awareness goes sky high. And then it begins to drop day by day. And whenever I go through a TSA line, I'm always counting the number of TSA people. And God bless TSA people, but I'm always counting them. And there are lots there. And I notice that most of them are talking to each other and not eyes on the threat, which are people coming through metal detectors, people coming through. It's always at least 2-1, not doing anything remotely protective, and one doing the screening and one with the wand doing irrelevant things. I don't know that we've ever caught a terrorist coming through TSA. It's a remarkable expenditure of money. And for very, because it's been 22 years, right? We're about to come up on the 22nd anniversary of 9/11. So our guard is down. Thank God the guard wasn't down for this good. Just call him a hero. Don't call him a good Samaritan if that bothers you. Call him a hero. He was a hero. ReliefFactor.com works heroically with your natural anti-inflammatory to keep you in the game. As I said, I got a 10K coming up here in Maine in a few weeks. And after the injury in Virginia 7 weeks ago, it's been a while. But yesterday I got Saturday I got 8 miles in. Today I'm going to walk, and it's recovery day. I'll do another 10K tomorrow. Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, 10Ks. Walking in between or not doing anything. And ReliefFactor.com, I was without it for a week, and it was like losing a friend because it was, you know, my friend who helps my body get back to working the right way. And ReliefFactor.com does that. And I've got this neck problem, and everybody in Maine's giving me the same name of the physical therapist to go to do the neck traction. And I tell you very bluntly, it's not going to work if your C5 and 6 are jammed together and the nerves in between. It's not going to do a thing for you. But if you ran and you're sore, it does. All right, it's for exercise and aging. It's not for compressed discs. Get me, don't oversell. Under promise, over perform. That's what ReliefFactor.com does. $19.95 will get you started. Go take it. Join me, and I'll be right back on the Hugh Hewitt Show. Welcome back, America. I'm watching with great interest because it will impact you and me and everybody, the race to replace Boris Johnson. And if you've just been on vacation, don't know, Boris Johnson has announced his resignation as soon as the Conservatives, 348 members of Parliament, select two people to be voted on by the 200,000 members of the Tory party, official members of the 200,000. So a vote goes out. Once they get the candidates down to two, they're at five right now. One will be tossed out today who has the fewest support. That will be Tommy Tuggenhut. And then they'll have four. And then I don't know what happens. It'll be Rishi Sunak and three women. Penny Mordaunt, Liz Truss, Kemi Badenoch. I am greatly impressed with Kemi Badenoch. And I should have known I would be. I don't know much about her. I know very little about, you know, I read the Telegraph every day. I read the Financial Times every day. I knew a lot about Boris Johnson. I was big with Brexit. The British politician I think I am most closely aligned with is named Michael Gove. And I wanted him to run. And he is not. He looks completely like a geek, right? But he's just all brains and no charisma. But Michael Gove came out and said, we got to go with Kemi. And Kemi Badenoch is 42 years old, mother of three. Born in the United Kingdom to Nigerian parents, she was primarily raised in Nigeria and came back from Nigeria to the United Kingdom for her final years in high school and college because Nigeria was killing each other. And her physician father and her mother said, we got to get you out of here. And they took her back to the land of her birth, the United Kingdom. And she's black. She's amazingly charismatic, but she is somewhat untested. She has held sort of deputy cabinet level posts, nothing major, no great office of state. And Liz Truss is the foreign secretary and Rishi Sunak is the chancellor of the exchequer. And everyone kind of thought those two would square off. But Liz Truss has completely underwhelmed everyone. And it's just like Theresa May 3.0, because we skipped the 2.0 and changed nothing and went right to Liz Truss 3.0. And you're wondering, can she really? And Rishi Sunak took a bite out of her last night with this. Let's play cut number 11. Rishi Sunak, the chancellor.
We have a choice. My question's for Liz, actually. Liz, in your past, you've been both a Liberal Democrat and a Remainer. I was just wondering which one you regretted most.
I am somebody who was not born into the Conservative Party. I went to school in Paisley and Leeds. I went to a comprehensive school. But my fundamental belief and the reason I am a Conservative is I saw kids at my school being let down in Leeds. I saw them not get the opportunities, not get the proper educational standards that you might have got at your school.
Okay, so Rishi Sunak is your classic Oxbridge guy. And he's very wealthy, he's very smart, and he's very flashy, and he's in his 30s. And Liz Truss is in her 40s, I think, and she's the one who's saying, I'm Reaganite in my backstory. And I've been reading the British press very closely. They're both competent people. They won't be disastrous. I don't know if they can lead a revolution. Kemi Badenoch, cut number 16, her closing pitch.
I said that I was the candidate who would tell you the truth, and I am. I'm doing this not for myself, but for the future. I have three children, and I want the very best future for them. It is vitally important that we create a strong United Kingdom that is confident in itself. I moved to this country nearly 30 years ago, and the United Kingdom is a beacon of shining light in the world. That's why so many people want to come here, and we need to make sure that we keep it so. So a future that is confident, bright, strong, secure, with a wealthier economy. That's what I'm about. I'm the candidate for the future. I'm here to be honest with you. I can make a change and change things for the better.
So it would be radical. All right. It would be a radical shift to the Tories to make that the face of their party. And I think I'm for it. Rishi is going to be a pretty radical change, even though he's the canton of continuity. He's wedded to a platform of tax hikes and global alarmism about climate. Kemi Badenoch is out of right field. She is like Thatcher taking over from Heath in the 70s. And if you're not old enough to remember that, that was quite the, they figured Thatcher would get pummeled at the next general election. She won and ruled for 11 years. And so this could really affect NATO and the West, and it will give the lie to all the, you know, systemic racism nonsense that's part of wokeism. But that's not a reason for someone to run the country, to be for or against wokeism. It's a reason to go and join the Job Creators Network, rockthewoke.com, That's a good thing to do, but it's not a reason to vote for a prime minister. A reason to vote for the prime minister is the future. What's our country going to be like, free and independent of the European Union? How are we going to move forward? And if she would just promise to keep Ben Wallace at the Ministry of Defense and make Michael Gove the Chancellor of the Exchequer, I think she'd make it to the final two and win in a walk. I just do. But I she hadn't done that yet. Maybe she's saving that up for the round. They go from 5 to 4 today. She'll still be in. And then she has to take votes away from Liz Truss and Penny Mordaunt. And Penny Mordaunt is all ambition, as far as I can tell. And Liz Truss is Theresa May, and Rishi is Mr. Taxman. And so will the Conservative Party genuinely embrace Thatcherism? And I think to genuinely embrace Thatcherism, opportunity, growth, out of regulations, a strong defense, a leader of NATO, a leader of the world, I think that's Kemi Badenoch. But we will see. No bad choices here, but there is one truly radical and really head-turning choice. It's Kemi. And I will talk more about that next hour. Come back for hour number 3 of this Monday edition of the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by The Wild Adventure. Learn more at twa.us.
Morning, Glory America. Bonjour. Hi, Kennedy. Hugh Hewitt from Studio Winterfell, way up north. I escaped the Beltway last week, but not before running into my friend Ilya Shapiro, who is a senior fellow at the Manhattan Institute. Ilya is really one of the smart guys about con law. Hello, Ilya. Good morning. Good to see you.
Good morning, Hugh. Welcome back from your vacation. I'm back from mine. Kurt was all right, but it's good to be with the show's namesake.
Thank you. Thank you. Now, Ilya, the long wake for Roe continues in legacy media. I mean, we're going to have this for a year. They're going to have sit Shiva for a year over Roe v. Wade and Planned Parenthood v. Casey. Meanwhile, the states are moving back to what they ought to be doing. I want to look ahead. I've done what SCOTUS did a lot. I've written 3 Washington Post columns on West Virginia versus EPA alone. I want to look ahead to the next term because I think it's going to be as big, at least on the ending of use of race to award benefits or inflict penalty and many other. What's ahead, Ilya, for next year?
It's going to be another big term. The court's not taking a year off. There's affirmative action in Harvard and UNC. There's a case called 303 Creative, which builds on Masterpiece Cake Shop, the baker who didn't want to make a cake for a same-sex wedding. This time it's a graphic designer and a website, so no question that this is First Amendment protected activity. Big cultural case. You mentioned West Virginia versus EPA, which I think is the longest lasting decision this term jurisprudentially. Next term, a case like that also involves the EPA, but the Clean Water Act and regulating the so-called waters of the United States. If they're navigable waters, even if it's puddles, the EPA comes in and you can't build on the land. The case called Sackett, second time that litigation has gotten to the Supreme Court. And California has been regulating the rest of the country, you might have heard, in lots of different ways. There's a pork producers case. You're thinking, agricultural regulation, California, why is that important? Well, when they set the standard, whether it's for emissions, for agriculture, it's not like manufacturers, agricultural companies do one thing for the California market and another thing for the rest. No, that sets national standards. And so there's something that lawyers call the dormant commerce clause or a state regulating interstate commerce that comes up. That's just a few of the big cases. And there's more. And election regulation, of course. When a state court rewrites what the legislature has done. This came up a number of times in Pennsylvania in the last election, but this is a case out of North Carolina. So the court is going to decide that, hopefully, once and for all.
Now, Ilya, you and I will agree 9 out of 10 times. So I want to go in reverse order, if I can remember it, of the cases you marked out. And I've retired from the practice of law. I still teach it. I know the 404 case upwards and downwards, and it's time for them to get back to the Clean Water Act and really crush Rapanos and Justice Kennedy's, maybe it is, maybe it isn't a wetland. But let's do reverse order. The state election law case, here's the nut of it. All of this stuff that we have been living through since January 6th, and indeed since 2016, is because of the Pennsylvania Supreme Court taking away the right to draw districts from the state legislature. It's a long time past, and the Supreme Court didn't want to touch it. Will they get in and finally say, and I think it would fall at the same time, no more independent commissions, no more state Supreme Courts, it's up to state legislators to draw a legislative district, which is what the framers intended, in my opinion.
Well, look, luckily I get paid to analyze and advocate rather than predict. And this one is the toughest one to, I think, predict of any of those that we've talked about. Because, for example, in the redistricting cases, the court ultimately threw up its hands and said, look, there's no constitutional standard for when the politicians take politics too much into account in partisan gerrymandering. Here, this might be similar. It might not be a good thing for state Supreme Courts to rewrite the law, but what is the federal constitutional standard? Is it the time, place, and manner clause that states can establish the time, place, and manner of elections? Is it voting rights, basically, but people aren't being denied their voting rights based on race or sex or other equal protection sort of things. So the key question is, will the Supreme Court find a federal constitutional standard to apply when it's a dispute between the state Supreme Court and the state legislature? I don't know, honestly.
I think it will. I think it will say the text of the Constitution and the original intent, not altered by the 14th Amendment, was to leave these decisions to state legislatures, not Supreme Courts, and within the context of what you carefully articulated, no use of race, no use of gender, equal numbers of people in every legislative district. The rest of it is, and by the way, these independent commissions have absolutely no precedent. either in 1789 or in 1868. There's no way that an independent commission is supposed to make these decisions. And there's no way. I also don't see them extrapolating to the Supreme Court, Ilya. Do you really think there are five votes to say state Supreme Courts can do whatever they want? Because some of them are nuts.
No, probably not. I mean, what they're going to, I think we're going to see this in oral argument is they're going to, you know, they want to rule that way. What you're saying is eminently sensible. But what is the standard? Because ultimately, you know, state courts do have the power to interpret state law when there's a question of how to interpret that election law. That needs to be applied and decided by the state Supreme Court. But what is the standard for when they go too far? Is it that they're denying a Republican form of government? Is it that they're usurping the legislative authority? I don't know how that I haven't yet dug into the briefs, so I don't know how that resonates. I don't think the briefs have all been filed yet, for that matter. But it's going to be a tough one to look at.
Okay, let's go to one where conservatives divide, the pork case, in the dormant commerce clause, or the negative commerce clause. And I tell people they don't know boring until they've sat through these cases, and I hate teaching them. I don't know if you like
this
teaching them.
This is my favorite area, Hugh. It's my favorite area.
I knew it. No, I tell the students we are about to go through the desert. This is the part of a Deuteronomy where you're going to wander through the dormant commerce clause. You've got to explain, people, states can't interfere with the flow of commerce. That's what I start my students on. You know, if there's a river and it's starting up in Minnesota and it's ending in New Orleans, states can't charge tolls along the way. That's like the basic story. What does the pork producer regulation do other than interfere with state commerce?
Right. But the question is the way that you boil down the jurisprudence, and it's not clear. And, you know, ultimately, you know, I filed a brief at the cert stage to get the Supreme Court to take this case. And I support the pork producers because I think what California is doing is really setting standards for the country. But I hope even if that position loses, as it might, because, for example, you mentioned this divides conservatives, Gorsuch and Thomas, I think, are going to rule for California here. They don't like the Dormant Commerce Clause unless it's a clear situation like that tolls of the highway or the river or whatever. But it's a very heterodox. You might see the liberal split as well, for that matter. I mean, it doesn't match up with normal ideological divisions. But I hope they clarify the standard, because currently there's what's called a Pike balancing test. And whenever you have a balancing test, I mean, typically, whoever the swing justice just kind of throws up their hands and says, "Okay, let's go this way." And it's very hard, again, hard to predict. But a better standard would be very useful.
Yeah, I agree, and I think that standard should be: do not interfere with people doing business lawfully. Now, let me move to the Rapanos decision, the 404. I actually did this for 30 years. They've got to get the core
303. Yeah. Is it Atlanta 303? Anyway, we're going to make a joke about area codes, but whatever.
Well, I'm telling you right now, they have to get the core out of this. And Justice Kennedy gave them a chance to try and write their house. They did nothing. I'm retired now, Ilya. It put my kids through college getting these permits. I'm glad it was confusing as hell for 30 years. It's got to stop. People do not owe their allegiance to the United States Army Corps of Engineers. It assaults property rights. Do you think we see property rights begin to resurrect in this case?
I think so. I mean, the Sacketts previously won their right to even contest this suit. And, you know, this is, again, this is a cleanup last term was a cleanup of Justice O'Connor on religion. This term might be a cleanup of Justice Kennedy on interstate commerce and property rights and Clean Water Act, Clean Air Act, those sorts of things. As you said, Rapanos, you know, you don't really want to get into the weeds, but clearly when it's just stuff that is you cannot navigate. I don't care how shallow your pontoon is, you're not going to navigate that particular water. And
it's worse than that, Ilya. Underground rivers that only run in California are regulated by the Army Corps of Engineers. It destroys the ability to use the land, and we've got to have a standard that if you take my land, you pay for it. Now, quickly on to creative. I think this is big because Justice Barrett said 2 years ago, we got to come up with a new standard. Smith doesn't work. And she's had 2 years to think about it. Are we going to get a new standard?
I don't know if we're going to need to overturn Employment Division versus Smith, because which is a case that says if you want a religious exemption, you need to get it from the legislature if it's a neutrally applicable law. But the court has been saying you're purposely targeting religious institutions. And I think they're going to find a way to say the same thing here. Not quite with the smoking gun that they had with Masterpiece Cake Shop, where the commissioners were actively bigoted in their statements. But like we saw in the two terms ago with adoption standards in Philadelphia, that they disqualified the Catholics because they wouldn't refer rather than give direct placements to gay couples. Here they're going to say, look, there's no problem here. You've manufactured this problem. There are plenty of other website designers you could go to, and you're targeting with this litigation, with this prosecution by the Civil Rights Commission of this particular.
Oh yeah, can you stick around for a segment? Can you stay one more segment? I want to talk about affirmative action because I think it's dead. But I'll trust the coroner to be Ilya Shapiro.
We also haven't yet plugged my book, so need to do that.
Welcome back, America. Ilya Shapiro is really one of the smart people on American constitutional law, and I wanted to talk to him about the case that I think is the most important, at least in terms of my audience feeling its impact in a real way. This is the one that's going to hit most of the people listening, and it is the affirmative action case involving Harvard. You say, I didn't go to Harvard. Well, it's going to be about everything. And Ilya, I want to start with my favorite John Roberts quote. And the chief and I have known each other since we worked together in the White House in 1985 and 86. And I love him. I think he's a terrific chief justice. He's not a close friend. I just think he's a great man. He wrote in 2007, the way to stop discrimination on the basis of race is to stop discriminating on the basis of race. That's from a famous case called Community School, Parents Involved in Community Schools versus Seattle School District Number 1. I think that's the key to America. I think that's everything in our future. We can go down one path where race matters or another where don't bring it up. And this is, it's teed up in the Harvard case. What's going to happen? Are we going to get another statement from the chief like this that resonates?
Well, this is a place, as you said, that where John Roberts is not squishy. And I don't think Kavanaugh is going to be squishy based on what we've seen of him. So we could not just, hand a technical win and say Harvard is a black box. We don't know how they're using race. Lower courts, go figure it out again, which is what happened and was not very good in the UT Austin Fisher case a number of years ago. I think this is ripe for a complete demolition of this this edifice based on this diversity rationale that got exactly one vote in 1979 in the Bakke case, a challenge to racial preferences at UC Davis Medical School, where there were four justices that said you can use race all the time to remedy past wrongs, four justices who said, no, this is against the 14th Amendment, can't do it, and one, Lewis Powell, who said, well, diversity in education is a compelling interest. And so all of this, for 40 years, all of our fights have been based on that thin reed. And so I think, as with Roe v. Wade and some other precedents that have been thrown out in recent years, I think this is finally where the court says there's no way to do this. There's we have to kick this whole rotten can away.
If the country survives 100 years, Ilya, I think we will look back at the Burger Court era as a disaster that befell American jurisprudence, and that the Trump justices, led by the Chief Justice and Justice Thomas and whoever else is the sixth, so I'm forgetting, there's six conservatives, let us out of the forest in 2022 to 2024. That we just said, we're getting out of here, and we're going to blowtorch our way out. We're going to dump Roe and Casey. We're going to dump Bakke and its progeny. We are going to dump the regulatory state. We're just getting out of this forest because we have no business being here. Are you as optimistic as I am?
I am, but I think John Roberts, the Chief Justice, is being brought there kicking and screaming in many ways. Of course, you know, he voted to uphold the Mississippi abortion law, but not to overturn Roe. As I said, on this area on race, he's not been squishy, but in many other areas, he is very much committed to minimalism and institutionalism, whatever that means, rather than originalism and textualism. So it's a very vibrant set of justices on the right who disagree with each other from time to time. And this term, they all defected at least twice, quote unquote, defected in 5-4 cases, except Alito, that should be noted. But this is indeed, you know, this is the term that finally, the hoped for, feared, expected conservative majority finally coalesced, because you have you already have six votes, so you can afford to lose one. So it's beyond the margin of defection.
I think the Chief Justice wants to clear cut his way out of the forest, just like everyone else. But he didn't want anyone to notice. And the difference is that you cannot not be noticed. You're going to either take the trees down and get out or not. I think we escape, Ilya. And by this, do you agree with that race is noxious? That the whole American founding was flawed because of race. The 14th Amendment was supposed to end that flaw, and we're back in there, using race everywhere. And we've got to get out, or we cannot survive as a free republic. Do you agree with that?
I do. And so-called race relations have gotten worse in the last 20 years, not because people have gotten more racist, but because of activists and you know, what I guess in the 80s were called race hustlers have inflamed things, the 1619 Project and all of that, the anti-racism, the, you know, my run-in with the diversity, equity, inclusion office at Georgetown, which is Orwellian, you know, subverts intellectual.
If you
diversity.
Want to stick around and talk about that, Ilya, if you do, tell
to.
Dwayne.
We need to plug Trump. My book out in paperback, Supreme Disorder. Judicial nomination.
Oh, stay with us then. We'll plug away in the next segment with Ilya Shapiro. I asked him for 10 minutes. I'm keeping him for 40. Makes for a great podcast, though. Stay tuned, America.
I already got my kids breakfast, so it's all good.
Good morning. What can I get started for you?
Hi, can I please get a plain cheeseburger Happy Meal?
Oh, I'm sorry. We're not serving lunch for another 5 minutes. We're only serving breakfast.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. This Monday morning, I'm up down east, and I'm talking with Ilya Shapiro, who is down in the Beltway. Ilya is a fellow at the Manhattan Institute and recently went through a trial with Georgetown University's Woke Law School, and he emerged on the other side, leaving them behind in the victor. He's the author of Supreme Disorder. More importantly, he just understands this. He ought to be on a legacy network every night, actually just talking about the law if you really want to understand it, because Ilya is fun. So I ran into him last week at a gathering of young conservatives. Not so young conservatives anymore, actually. I'm old, but they're not 25 anymore. And Glenn Youngkin was my guest. By the way, what did you, without revealing what was said, Chatham House rules, what did you make of Glenn Youngkin, Ilya?
He's dynamic. I mean, I was delighted that he's my governor. I've lived in Virginia for almost 8 years now. And I actually was running for school board in Falls Church City last fall, and I teased Governor Youngkin that I did better than he did, at least in my jurisdiction. I thought he's bringing he and Jason Meares as the attorney general. They're really saving the state from the direction that it had been going. We'll see what comes in future, and I don't know if he's really a viable presidential candidate, as has been said. He's in his first elected position, and we'll see how things go, the nature of the race. But no, I like him.
No, I do too. And I think Winsome Sears is also in our rising star category, but it's a divided state and it's a purple at best state. And the Beltway influence is giant, and Amazon is coming. Now, Ilya, I'm going to let you tell the story. I want the audience to understand that the American Legal Academy is broken, very badly broken. I may be the last conservative teaching on the West Coast. John Woo's up at Berkeley, and I only do it every other year because I'm 66 and I'm tired of dealing with this. I hate faculty meetings. I think you made the right choice in running away from Georgetown. But tell people the story, because it illustrates what's wrong with the Legal Academy.
Sure. So I had been at the Cato Institute, the nation's leading libertarian think tank, for nearly 15 years, and had the opportunity to make a change, have a different sort of impact. Got a really interesting offer from Georgetown to be the executive director of its Center for the Constitution. Now, as it turns out, the rest of the institution is the Center Against the Constitution. But I was going to be working with Randy Barnett, a notable constitutional legal scholar professor. And a few days before I was set to join Georgetown was when news of Justice Breyer's retirement broke. And there was a media firestorm, of course, and I was giving comment. And late that evening, I was in my hotel room in Austin, Texas. This probably wouldn't have happened if I wasn't traveling, because I tend not to doom scroll Twitter from home. But I was, you know, in my room, and before going to bed, just getting upset by President Biden's decision to limit his selection pool by race and sex. He was going to fulfill his campaign promise to appoint a black woman. So I thought, if I were a Democratic president, if I wanted to advance progressive legal ideas, who would I pick? And I thought Sri Srinivasan, the chief judge of the D.C. Circuit, very well-known and respected scholar, advocate, now judge. Indian American happens to be, would be the first of that kind to get your identity politics points. Also an immigrant. So a great story, and would be very, very effective. But of course,
very smart, very influential, very smart.
Yeah, was on the short list for the nomination that went to Merrick Garland under Obama. But of course, he's disqualified because, as I put it, doesn't fit into the latest hierarchy of intersectionality. And so by order of logic, everyone else in the entire universe, if I think he's the best, everyone else is less qualified, is a lesser candidate. And based on Biden's criteria, that means we will end up with a, quote, lesser black woman. And it's those three words that really provoked the manufactured outrage on Twitter. My political enemies seized on that and tried to get me fired. And eventually I had a few days of hell. It was a very tough, intense period, trying to support my family, my livelihood, my reputation, everything else. And not because of Twitter. I don't care about the Twitter mob, but the real world, my job and my life. And the dean, who is no profile in courage, as we'll get to, of Georgetown, Bill Traynor, decided to onboard me and immediately suspend me with pay, administrative leave, to investigate whether my comments violated the university policies on harassment and anti-discrimination. And so began 4 months, to continue the analogy, of purgatory. The diversity office, the bureaucrats charged with this inquisition, interviewed me a few weeks in, basically asked several times, what did you mean by that tweet? You know, why was it so offensive? But this thing went on and on and on for more than 4 months. And it was quite clear that what they were waiting for was for the semester to end and the students to get off campus so they could try to kind of sweep this under the rug or slap me on the wrist or something. So eventually, one of the bright lawyers that they were paying, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars for to advise them, looked at the calendar and found I was not an employee when I tweeted, and therefore these policies don't apply to me. So, all right, I celebrated the technical victory. Okay, I get to go do my stuff. You know, it's technical, but I'm in the arena. But then landed in my inbox the detailed report from this this Office of Diversity in HR.
The Inquisition.
What's that?
The Inquisition.
Yes, yes. As I said, at Georgetown, it's called Institutional Diversity, Equity, and Affirmative Action. It's basically the opposite of whatever it's called. It's very Orwellian. And in reading this, along with my lawyer and Professor Barnett, my wife, who's a better lawyer than all of us, it became clear that this was untenable. What they said was, okay, they can't punish me because of this technicality, but note for future, and this, by the way, is a note for everyone else, not just me, anytime you say something or write something that somebody claims offense, that creates a hostile educational environment that subjects me to discipline or termination. So basically, very realistic scenario that they are setting me up for a fall. When I'm commenting with you right now on the affirmative action case and saying that judging people based on race violates the 14th Amendment, oh, someone's offended by that, and I get back into the star chamber. Or 303 Creative, you know, this offends the LGBTQIA++2 community, whatever it's called. So that subjective standard is not going to work, and they apply it unevenly. I presented in my 4-page resignation letter that I summarized in the Wall Street Journal, there have been very inflammatory, by any objective, not subjective standard, offensive tweets by Georgetown professors, and they weren't investigated or disciplined, nor should they have been, but it's free speech for thee and not for me, and I am not going to live like that. So I had what lawyers call a noisy withdrawal, and I've been using this platform in this moment to shine a light on the rot in academia generally and Georgetown specifically.
Now, Ilya, Georgetown Private University, it's a Catholic university. I'm Catholic. I'm embarrassed by it. I'm completely chagrined that a once mighty Catholic institution has fallen into persecuting people. Like the Inquisition was back, but it's an Inquisition from the left, not from the arch-conservatives. Did you think, have you considered, will you find a way to sue them on a situational slander basis? In other words, I'm thinking of the Neiman Marcus case where a defendant said something like, everybody who works at Neiman Marcus is a hooker. And there were 10 girls who worked at the Neiman Marcus fashion department, and the 9 of them who were not prostitutes sued, and they won. But this is different because they actually just targeted you and destroyed you, and they tarred and feathered you online and in reality, and they dragged you through. And it was a very public warning to everybody else, and everybody else in legal academia, we will come for you from the Inquisition. And like Oberlin faces a $10 million judgment by the bakery that got slandered by their Inquisition, Georgetown should pay the price. Are you going to do that?
Well, the statutes of limitations have not run and all on various claims, so I'm limited in what I can exactly say. I'm discussing with my lawyer all available options. There's also in D.C. Protection for political affiliation. There's also hostile work environment. There are different sorts of claims that are possible. You know, the juries in D.C. and Northern Virginia aren't terribly favorable as they might be in some other places. But I'm considering my options. I'll just say that. But look,
does Virginia have a law on the intentional infliction of emotional distress?
It does. I mean, that's
that, that seems to me to be the applicable tort. They intentionally dragged you along a rocky road and cut you with broken glass for 4 months. And I think the discovery would be fascinating, but it also would project. It would mean you have to go back in and do it again. I just don't know if you want to run in that. And I know you can't say anything, but you are considering all options.
Considering all options. I never exclude options. I'm very inclusive that way, Hugh.
And so What is the lesson for other academics?
Well, look, the thing is, the lesson is academia is a hostile place. I mean, are you a fully tenured professor, Hugh, or just an adjunct?
Yes.
I can't remember.
I'm fully tenured. I've been fully tenured since 96. I am the senior man in the area. They cannot touch me.
Yeah. Well, that's good. Well, you're grandfathered in also. Who knows what, each university might be slightly different, and maybe Chapman has the administrators have slightly more spine than Georgetown. I'm not sure. But the point is, what's gone on isn't that all of a sudden the liberals have taken over academia. I mean, newsflash, breaking. I mean, this has been going on for decades. So what happened to me, the lesson of this, is not the decades old sour grapes of conservatives that, liberals have taken over academia. I don't think the ratio among either students or faculty at Georgetown or higher education generally of liberals, conservatives, moderates is all that different from when I was in college 25 years ago or law school 20 years ago. What's changed is the proliferation of these diversity bureaucrats, diversocrats, and bureaucrats in general, who have to justify their own existence, and the spinelessness of administrators who kowtow or placate the radical illiberal, not liberal, but illiberal mobs that have narrowed and shifted the Overton window, the range of permissible policy expression. And these diversity offices run the show at this point. So Dean Traynor at Georgetown and others like him, most places, the deans, the presidents, et cetera, are not woke radicals. They're spineless cowards who...
I want to close on that note that the difference between you and me is Chapman is run by Daniele Struppa, whose response, and Matt Parlow. Their response to wokeism was to open a center for First Amendment freedom of expression. And they said, go to hell. To everyone out there who wants to shut down points of view, whether or not they're left, right, center, whatever, they move the Overton window back. And that's the only thing that works, Ilya. Last 30 seconds to you.
Absolutely. That's the thing. I'm very pessimistic about academia, but unlike the country writ large, I see green shoots in our society writ large. But the solution in academia is actually fairly simple. It's, as you said, those few administrators in places like Chapman or University of Chicago, or I went to law school, they say, look, we are not going to police wrong think and wrong speech. And that's it. And that shuts these things down. So all it takes is courage and enforcing generally the policies that they already have. But I'm pessimistic about whether they're going to do that.
Courage is the most important virtue because it is the one upon which all others depend. Ilya Shapiro, thank you for joining me. I, Shapiro, on Twitter. The book is Supreme Disorder.
And my new Substack, Shapiro's Gavel. Very important.
Shapiro's Gavel? All right. Yep. Go there. Subscribe. Support Ilya. Support him. I really do mean that. But plus, you'll be smarter. Time to talk about relieffactor.com. I talk about my sponsors every single morning, and I take this every single morning in the first hour, and I remind you two more times, relieffactor.com. I'm back up north, back in my studio, Winterfell, I call it, the furthest north studio that I have. I've got Studio Dorn in the west and Studio King's Landing inside the Beltway and Studio Winterfell. And I like Studio Winterfell because it's cool. It's not the swamp, and I like it because it's stocked with a Relief Factor to the rim. And I can't turn around without running into Relief Factor. And that makes me happy because I don't have to hunt for it in the morning. It's right there, and I take it, and I remind you, relieffactor.com works with the body's natural anti-inflammatory system by using Icarian and Curcumin, Resveratrol, and Omega. Four natural supplements, no drugs. Don't stop taking the drugs your doctor has told you to take, but do start taking the natural supplement, the only one I've ever endorsed, the only one I've ever taken, the only one I think you need. Up next, Hotline Josh is no longer Hotline Josh. He's Axios Josh Kraushaar. So go dump the Hotline Josh thing. You don't tweet anymore there. You have to go find Josh Kraushaar. We'll talk about what's ahead this summer on the next segment of the Hugh Hewitt Show. Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. The British members of Parliament who are Tories will vote between 1 and 3, or no, noon and 2 in the United States East Coast time today to eliminate one of five. Josh Kraushaar with Axios joins me. He's changed his Twitter handle. It's now just Josh Kraushaar. So now I have to spell Kraushaar, but I'll let him do it. Josh, has everyone migrated from Hotline Josh over to Josh Kraushaar on Twitter yet?
You know, it was a pretty easy process. So the one thing I've been working on, I lost the blue check. So
what?
Twitter rejected my application for the blue check. So I don't know. I'm going to apparently have to try again and have to figure out how to navigate that bureaucracy. But that's the only thing I lost in the process.
Well, they'll give it back because you are the key guy who's nonpartisan objective. I love being on Special Report with you. Maybe we'll do that again. Josh, I'm following closely whether or not anybody cares. They should care about who's going to be the next British Prime Minister. Are you following it?
You know, I was overseas for the last few weeks between jobs, and that was dominating international coverage, the Boris Johnson ousting. You know, I haven't followed all the coverage extensively, but I have watched with interest that Johnson didn't immediately step down. That there may be a lot of speculation I've read that there he may be trying to hang on to leadership by seeing if no one really emerges as a favorite for his successor in the Conservative Party.
I watch Kemi Badenoch. Michael Gove endorsed her early. I don't know enough to make a preference statement, but I do watch momentum and it's moving there. Josh, we have three, maybe four long months of doing nothing until the elections, because we'll get the CHIPS Act passed, we'll get a reconciliation bill, and then a continuing resolution, then we'll vote. Is anything going to happen other than those three things?
Well, the CHIPS Act isn't nothing, and it was held up for a little bit, and now there seems to be some momentum now that the Manchin scuttled the climate change legislation that was up in the air. But yeah, we're the politics of the summer are likely going to remain the politics of November. I don't foresee any huge dramatic changes in terms of the political environment. In fact, you know, a lot of studies show that, you know, people's perceptions of the economy for the midterms really stem from several months before when the election takes place.
Can Joe Biden go any lower than he already has gone? I actually think he's at the, I don't think he can fall off this floor.
Yeah, I mean, he's losing Democrats. He's losing a lot of folks within his own party that are dissatisfied with the lack of legislation, the lack of successes, the bad economy. So could it go lower? You know, he's at a he's at a historically low number for any modern era president right now. I think it's 38% in the Real Clear Politics average. But the big question for me is, you know, how many of those folks will end up voting in the midterms? How many of those are disillusioned Democrats who may still show up for the Democratic Party, or how many Democrats end up just staying home for the midterms because they're so dissatisfied with the state of the country?
Josh, I got to close by asking you this. I try and talk to as many people and listen as often to see what they bring up sua sponte. People bring up trans athletes, men who are now competing as women. They bring up woke schools and they bring up inflation. I think that is a dire situation for the Democrats. And this is not Hugh Hewitt. I rarely talk about trans issues. I rarely talk about, other than vote for everyone, throw out every incumbent who's not, you're not certain about at the school board level. And I always talk about inflation. Do you hear different things? Is there something I'm missing?
Well, look, Hugh, we've talked about this before, but education and some of those cultural issues were huge factors in the Virginia governor's race right outside of Washington, D.C., just a year ago. And I think they remain vulnerabilities for Democrats. Yeah, I mean, look, there was news over the weekend. Someone I know very well, Roy Teixeira, who was for a long time at the Center for American Progress think tank, said he couldn't work there anymore because his ideas were, you know, it was not, they ended up not wanting to touch a lot of these cultural hot button issues surrounding trans issues, surrounding gender, surrounding crime, even. And that's a problem for the Democratic Party if that's where your think tank is. If that's where the independent think tank is, where you're supposed to get the best data, the best research, the best, you know, the most objective facts out there, and you can't talk about certain issues because it's too politically sensitive, that's where the Democratic Party is experiencing some of those same
same problems, and it's going to hurt them. These are relevant issues to a lot of voters.
I think it's going to crush them. Josh Kraushaar, always a pleasure. Head over to Josh Kraushaar on Twitter. And Twitter, if you're listening, go give him his blue check back. The guy should be followed by everyone. Josh Kraushaar at Twitter. Let me close by talking to you about AndrewandTodd.com, because I waited to the very end of the show to tell you this. The 10-year Treasury is at 2.986% this morning, and the Fed's going to raise interest rates by a point this month. So if you're going to buy a home, it's going to get more expensive every week that you wait. So don't wait, get pre-qualified. If you're going to do a reverse mortgage, it's going to get more complicated every week that you wait, so don't wait. If you're a senior citizen and you're completely crushed by inflation because Social Security went up 5% and inflation went up 9%, you got to get money out of your house. The people to do it with are my friends, and I say friends quite carefully. I don't say that often. Andrew Del Rey, Todd Avakian, AndrewandTodd.com, sponsor this show for a decade. They are my good friends. You can trust them for your mortgage needs, reverse mortgage, first mortgage, refinance, whatever it is. You got credit problems, go to AndrewandTodd.com. AndrewandTodd.com, or call them at 888-888-1172 and come back tomorrow. Thank you, Adam. Thank you, Dwayne. Thank you, Jacob. I'll be back on the next Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Micron.